Hi, guys. This is Jean Holden, producer of the show. And I just wanted to take a minute to let you know where you can find us on the internet. Please go to ThatMan on FatMan.com. There you can find out all the things you need to know about the show. You'll be able to find links to the podcast, to YouTube, to Twitter, Facebook, even Instagram and Snapchat. Thank you so much for listening, guys, and we hope you enjoy the show.
Today's show is brought to you by Death Wish Coffee. Death Wish Coffee, the strongest coffee in the world.
This is Kevin Conroy, the voice of Batman, and I want to urge you to make a generous donation to the Wayne Foundation so we can stop the sexual trafficking of children. Do it, or I'll find you.
And don't forget to check out our good friend of the show, Mark Live, over at chundertunes.com for all your podcast animation needs.
That Man on Fat Man is recorded with a Zoom H6 handy recorder.
Zoom.
For creators.
Disclaimer. The show you're about to experience is for entertainment purposes only. The hosts use mature language and conversation just like in most of life. If you're too uptight, this might not be for you. All that said, we really do hope you enjoy the show. But if you don't enjoy it, expect a nice big shipment of my joyous Joker juice on your doorstep in the very near future. Toodles!
As the world's biggest Kevin Smith fan, I appreciate the fact that somebody finally made a podcast about that interesting motherfucker. So, yes, you absolutely did the right thing. It was smart. I appreciate it. I think you were right to do that.
Okay. What has two thumbs and is a huge fan of Kevin Smith? That man!
Yes, I am that man.
The juggernaut of a podcast.
We need a costumed vigilante is what we need. Justice can't be served unless it's being fought outside the system.
Here's what we're going to do, eh?
Oh, shit. It's that man. Who is he? He's that man. He's talking. Go get him, that man.
Well, once upon a time, a regular man read a book written by the Fat Man. Tough shit, written by old Kev Smith. Kev said go out and start a podcast, and so I did, and I had a real blast. But my obsession was driving my co-host nuts. Didn't want to bring the podcast down. Needed Porkchop Murphy to hang around. So I create a new show with one heck of a plan, and I'd call that show That Man on Fat Man, because we're going to chat about Kevin Smith. That's right, let's talk about old Kev Smith.
Yes, please note that use of all sound effects is done ironically.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to this episode 3-36, which technically really should be 37 in a row. I am your host, Scott Holden. Hang on, let me adjust my mic so I'm not all blocking my face. And I am your host of That Man on Fat Man. With me here in the studio on a different mic, so it's throwing me off, is none other than co-host and producer extraordinaire, Gene Holden.
Hi, guys. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. Yay! And we're so glad that 2016 is over.
Yeah.
Because it was a rotten year for most people.
America.
Yeah.
In general.
And we're happy to be here. Some housekeeping.
Okay.
So we were supposed to do a holiday show
mm-hmm.
with Michael Joseph Consolmagno. It would have been the second annual Star Wars Christmas special, but his family came down with a stomach flu and just really put the kibosh on all those plans.
And his kids are little, so that gets really messy.
Yeah, so...
I've been there.
So their whole family was down for Christmas. He didn't even see the movie until, like, I think yesterday or the day before.
Christmas was a washout, I think, for them, probably.
Yeah, so... we're still going to do the Rogue One show, even though, like, everybody, every podcaster and their brother has done a Rogue One show by now. But we're still going to do one.
But this will be our Rogue One show.
Technically, it'll be our holiday show. It'll just be belated because of illness.
Yeah.
And that also, it's funny because then Gene got the stomach virus.
And
yesterday morning, I was supposed to do a new BCJ. It's anytime, this is why I hate announcing things. Anytime I announce things, I get made a hypocrite. You know, like I said, oh, in a little while, we're going to have a guest on.
Well, by no fault.
And then you got sick.
By no fault of your own.
And the same with the Christmas show. We're going to have a Christmas show, but no Christmas show because. You know, of Michael Joseph's illnesses.
And you know what? Mine was a 24-hour thing. I can't even tell you how it came upon me. It was the weirdest thing.
Yeah, you're never sick.
I never puke.
She never gets
because
sick,
my body, like, shuts itself down, and I was actually puking nothing, like bile or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's over one day, and I'm back. But a little slower, though. I do feel a little funky, but it was one day, thank God.
Yeah.
Poor Joseph. I'm sorry, Michael Joseph, Consul Magno, and friends. I hope you guys are better.
They're back on their feet and all that. But
good.
At some point, we'll have to sit down and record our Rogue One show.
Yes.
But maybe this is a good time for the Smed Lines, do you think?
Okay. Yep.
All right. Well, here they are. Here comes the Smed Lines.
And now, direct from the Vat Cave, we give you the Smed Lines with Gene Holden.
And hi, guys. Welcome to the very first 2017 Smed Lines.
Woohoo!
Woohoo! Okay, so let's start off with Kevin's Supergirl episode. Now, that will be airing January 16th. We're all excited. It's episode 9, and we're in season 2. Now, there's a New Jersey out, too, with the Supergirl episode logo thingamajiggy on it. So check that out, too. Now, we're all sad by the news of Carrie Fisher. That was kind of a bummer, wasn't it?
Yeah. Kevin had a great tribute show.
That's what I'm kind
SModcast.
Of... SModcast. Yeah, I'm kind of want to talk about it a little bit. He shared a little bit on SModcast with Scott Mosier. He also shared the actual photo on Instagram, and basically, it was very short. It said, the princess stole my heart at age 7.
Yeah.
So.
Well, he wrote up a big thing, too.
And he wrote up a big thing, and I didn't really want to go on and on, but you can check out his Instagram. I mean, check out the latest SModcast with Scott Mosier.
It was really good. There's a couple things in there that, I mean, I'd be like, even I didn't know, but
no.
I mean, like, I knew a lot of the stories that he told. For instance, the Jay Muse story is kind of a staple
that
for Kevin.
So funny,
but then he gave a second part to that story that he never really
and
told
it was
before.
Really beautiful.
Yeah, it really was.
Thing.
And a couple other moments like that. The advice that he gave her was also. So,
yeah.
If anything, just listen to it for that stuff.
Yeah,
and it's a funny episode. He gets into his, the stuff with his dad.
Yeah.
You know, let's see, stuff like, I hate when this happens. Where's my cue?
Grace, fuck me and make me forget we got a stupid kid.
Oh, my God.
Grace!
Wrong Grace. So there you go. A lot of stuff from
Don.
I'm
sure Don would love to be around during these times, sharing all the excitement. And basically saying, like, anyone who knows me knows Carrie Fisher was my first love. So, all of us have some sort of, memory, not like personally with her, but, just something that, we love about her. And, it's sucky and... Kevin just seemed to, have a really emotional experience with her. So it's just, it's really cool and nice. He just brings him, down to like his humanness, like he always does. Well, on a lighter note, Stan Lee's birthday was December 28th. And how old the fuck is he?
Oh, wow. Yeah.
95?
95.
Crazy? Well, they had this.
What year was he born?
You know what?
You didn't write it down.
I did not. But he just turned like a huge number.
Older than dirt.
Older than dirt.
Actually, no, that's not true.
Dirt is older, but
no, yeah, it's he's older than fire, right. But not as old as dirt. So he's somewhere between dirt and fire.
But I'm telling you, the guy, like, and I don't know now if it's just he just has a smile on his face because he's like, oh my god, I'm here and I'm sitting and I'm having a good time, but he's just like smiling.
And he's always he's still good for some zingers too.
Well, speaking of zingers, they. There was a marvelous...
Well, Jay was talking to him, and hang on. There was some of this they talked a little bit about on Blowhard.
Right.
Which is, you know, a show that I've been listening to a lot of. If you're a fan, I would highly advise listening to Blowhard with Malcolm and Jay, although Jay's going to be off for a few weeks. But, he did talk about that, about that Jay has been sort of directing...
Yeah.
And, so he's been... Hang on a minute. I forgot. What the fuck are we talking about? I just lost my train of thought.
Well, we were actually talking about Stan Lee.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He directed... direct Stan Lee. That's what right. That's
like
right.
Marvel... Something...
And, of course, what's his name?
The name of the movie.
And Jay was talking about how when he called up Stan Lee, he was like, oh, Kevin never calls me. And, you know, so he still has a sense of humor.
That's what Stan Lee said?
Well, yeah, but he's just ribbing him because he knows he talks to him and stuff. He's like, why? Right. You know, I'd rather work with you than that crazy Kevin. You know, he does that kind of.
That's a good impression.
Good, yeah.
It's pretty good.
Excelsior.
Excelsior.
How can you not do Stan Lee?
Yeah. I liked him in Yoga Hosers, too. He was adorable. But he's always adorable.
God
whenever he
damn
does. Like,
Yoga
he
Hosers.
Around.
Although I think that was supposed to be Mosier's part.
I think so.
He stole Mosier's part.
Yeah, but how cool is that?
Yeah.
I mean,
now you
Mosier
just hear Mosier in the background.
Yeah. Well, Scott Mosier can say, wow, Stan Lee did
there is a call. Like, they're listening to the radio.
Yeah.
And the radio call-in. That's where Mosier is now.
That's Scott Mosier.
Which was recorded on the SModcast.
Well, so Stan Lee, and speaking of Jay Muse, the reason why he's probably not in Blowhard is because he's in Texas with Marilyn and with Scott Schiaffo and with Brian O'Halloran and with Stan Lee.
And he's directing.
And he's directing. Madness in the Method,
I believe
that's is the
it.
Movie.
Yeah.
So, Marvelous New Year's Eve. Marvelous, I'm sorry, I said that wrong. Marvelous Nerd Year's Eve was just...
last night.
Was just last night. Well, it's like a few day kind of con thing they've been doing. They had a roast. They had a roast for Stan Lee, and apparently Brian O'Halloran like stole the show.
Awesome.
Who, like, we're not surprised.
Yeah,
because Brian O'Halloran,
he's a cut-up.
Grab a microphone and he's so funny.
Yeah.
So if you can get pieces of that somehow on YouTube, I know Marilyn shared this like picture of like absolute horror, and she was just petrified having to do this roast, but I'm sure she did great. So that sounded like a fun night, too. And Hollywood Babylon Eve was last night, too. That was sold out.
Yep.
And that sounded
can't wait
like
to hear it drop.
Time. Yeah.
Probably so Monday, I guess.
Yeah, so that'll
tomorrow.
That'll drop.
What day is it? I don't even know. It's New Year's Day. I know that. But what day is New Year's Day? Is it Sunday or Monday?
New Year's Day is today.
Yeah, I know.
It's Sunday. Yes.
Okay. Yes, it's Sunday. All right.
So, yeah, I mean, that's it for the Smed Lines. Check out number 366, Good Night, Sweet Princess, which is SModcast 366. And there you go.
This has been the Smed Lines with Gene Holden.
And we're back to the two shot.
Yes.
You don't see the video that's going on.
Oh, what was that one?
You'll
was
see
that
it
just
again.
Me?
Yeah, it was just you for the... It's bad. And so, you know, we're going to have to, as our video progresses, to those out there who are listening, yes, there's a video of this up on the YouTubes and probably on the Facebooks as well.
And we're going to try to keep
it. I've been expanding my video prowess because I'm now doing a 5-day daily show. I brought back Bone Crushing Juggernaut as my own personal bully pulpit and venting house, really about politics and about me. So I don't have to vent on this show anymore.
Right.
So I can keep this, you know, innocuous and free of politics because I'll get my druthers out over there.
And there are many druthers.
Yes. And because it's a 5-day a week and it's not as, like, the shows aren't as long and it's primarily video. And then I'm like in the way Fatman on Batman does it. Then I'm going to group them up and drop them as a podcast once a week.
Oh, cool.
You know, can put them all together. Concatenate? Is that what that is? No. I think it is.
Concatenate?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Going back to my computer terms, concatenate a file. So this is our, if, in case you're wondering, well, what's the show this week? This is our second annual year in review. Mm-hmm. It's our, what we believe are the top 10 best moments of 2016.
Right.
We did this last year with 2015. It's a great show. I still refer people to it, especially new people. I'll be like, oh, you want to get an idea of what it is we do,
oh, yeah.
Go over and this is a good one.
Yeah, it is.
You know, the top 10 moments of 2015, because 2015 was, for the show, an incredible year. Mm-hmm. And although 2016 was fucking horrible in general to the general public.
For the Americas.
Yeah, we got a rotten president who I personally believe didn't really win the election, but had it stolen for him. We had to bear with that whole election all year. We lost so many celebrities.
Right till the very end.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Did who passed? Father Mulcahy
from MASH.
The
priest. Yesterday. Oh, my God.
One more snuck in under the wire, although I think that was kind of like, you're really trying when it's Father Mulcahy.
I know, but he was so cute and adorable. He was like so innocent and sweet. I loved him in that. God, of all people, it's like...
So 2016, for most, was kind of a rotten year. We get that.
It was.
But I will say that for the show, not a bad year at all. Pretty good. Pretty darn good year. And so we've picked out what we think are the best top 10 moments. And it's more like... Because not everything is like... It's not like top 10 guests. It's not like top 10... You know, because
we couldn't do that.
Yeah, there are events and there's just cool stuff that happened.
Right.
And so wherever possible, if it's not like, hey, this was a great guest and that's why the show was picked, you know, we pick a clip that kind of complements what we're talking
right.
about.
And just to branch off a little bit, for the movie, for what's the podcast, also amazing year.
Yeah.
So
of course. Yeah,
it's all in one. Like, it's just been a great year for the movie, for the podcast, and it's just been a lot of fun.
Yeah. And so with that, we'll jump into the top 10 list, and I should bust out my Casey Kasem the top 10. Here's the top 10 best moments of That Man on Fat Man for the year 2016. On the pop charts and on the soul charts, we're calling it a long-distance dedication. For your vagina.
Oh, shoot.
I should get this out of the way in advance, too. Let me see.
For your vagina.
For your vagina. No, not that. No. I'm trying to let that one go. My soundboard got all messed up. I don't know where anything is anymore. Oh, but this I should always know. All right.
I love you, Kevin, but really? And now they put like a beat on the back?
That was from, there's some comic book man.
He says it so many times.
Alright, that is just to annoy my wife. Now, with that little...
Do I look annoyed? Yeah, a little bit.
Well, they can see you now, too, so they know if you look annoyed.
And you know that my nose is...
All right, coming in at number 10, our first cut for the best of... I've actually picked two clips for this particular guest, for this particular show, because I couldn't choose. They're both really good, and one they highlight two different... I have something in my head. They highlight two different moments. They highlight...
Figure it out. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So our first moment is with Dan McCoy.
Oh, yes.
He was back on show number, 304 with Dan McCoy. There's two cuts I'm going to play. The first one is a little more heavy, and the second one's a little more light. And well, the first one is having to do with the time I met him filming.
Oh, yes.
And just to fill you guys in, the first time we met him was to film for the documentary we were making, and it was him and Elliot and Stuart, the guys he podcasts with. They do a podcast called The Flop House.
Right.
And And he also is a writer for The Daily Show. And so when we first met him, it was when John had just left, Trevor had just come in, and also he's in the middle of divorce, and also he had a cat dying in the other room. So without any further ado, here comes this cut.
Hey, any chance of a...
Oh, I should also say, also joining us on this clip for the show was Nick Franco. Good friend of the show, and because he's a big Flophouse fan, and so
he was thrilled.
This really is a great show. If you have a chance, go back, listen to show 304. You won't regret it. Mm-hmm. All right, so I'm going to mute us for a second. We're going to put this back on. Damn, you're on a different mic.
Hey, any chance of a cage miss in May or something? Or
I'm not on my game. I'm playing the wrong cut first. All right. That was what I wanted to do is cut two. Let's try this again. One more time. Dumb schmuck that I am. I'm glad you brought up The Daily Show because you just reminded me of another thing that was going on like the first time I met you. Like the show had just transitioned hosts. Probably it might have been like the first week even or maybe the first week or two tops.
Definitely infancy of Trevor.
Oh, and I was like, I just remember being like, the show sucks.
That was not the best way to, along with the cat, not the best way to hit it at all.
Yeah. I know, but I mean, I was being partly tongue-in-cheek, because I am sort of that way, but at the same time, I was like a wounded fan, who was like, I lost my Jon Stewart, and this guy is not cutting it.
Well, let's skip to the end, though, where you
exactly.
You like the show.
Yes, we can say it. And thank God for Hulu, really, because what would happen is I'd be watching my nightly show, and then, of course, next thing it would do, it would start playing The Daily Show. So I'd be doing something, and it would just autoplay, and next thing I know, I'm like, oh, that's funny. That's funny. And here's really, from an outsider looking in, this was my perspective completely. It felt like, at first, the writers, so you guys, were really still writing for John. And I could hear his voice in the writing so much. And it was like, and I'm looking at this guy who's from South Africa, who's not from New Jersey, who has no insider perspective like that. And it feels like the jokes are like that. I'm like, I could do these jokes better because I'm from Jersey. But I got my jersey out. But then you could tell that you guys shifted. And you found his voice and you started writing more. It felt like to me from more of an outsider perspective, which made a lot more sense and allowed him to demonstrate his comic sensibilities. So, and then you won me over. So,
Well, I mean, there's a limit to how much I can say about backstage stuff, but I think that that's very true. I think that we had a very short time to get the show back up and running after John left, only a few months, which is not a lot of time for to do this kind of thing. And it was a process of, literally getting to know someone new
while
we're
making
a television show.
Yeah, you were still, like, cranking out the sausage. You know what I mean? Like, we're doing what we always did. So, there was definitely that period. And it was, but now it does really feel like you're coming in your own. So there you go. That was
cranking out the sausage. That's such a U-term.
I was so cool, though, that I was able, I felt so cool being able to explain that to him.
Well, and the fact that he said, you're pretty much right. Yeah. Because how much of time, that they had such a short amount of time.
I just read the book, The Daily Show, and at least John knew.
He knew.
Like a good year beforehand that he was
really
leaving when he did.
That's really interesting, that book. I would recommend that to everyone who's interested. Yeah.
If you're in The Daily Show, a lot of people we met this year are in that book.
Oh, my God, Liz
Elliot Kalian, Liz Winstead. You know, it's it was so cool because the perspective.
And guess the other thing that happened in 2016, we lost The Nightly Show, the coolest show.
Yeah. But good news, Larry Wilmore. I think with ABC.
ABC.
All right, so here's the second cut. This is a little more lighter, a little more. What I like about this cut, we make him laugh.
Yeah.
So, and just also, here's another reason we pulled this cut. Right now, if you go over to the Flophouse, it is currently, their current show is their Cage Miss episode, which is something they do each year at Christmas time. They do Nick Cage Christmas.
Brilliant.
They do a movie on Nick Cage. And they have like a whole thing. And I just think this is a great cut about Nick Cage and the relevance and all that. So here this comes.
Hey, any chance of a Cage Miss in May or something? Or
I will definitely do the usual Cage Miss in July, I think. I think that's become a tradition. We're almost to the point now that we have enough of these like made-up holidays that it's like, it's, you know, like fitting in just normal movies with like made-up holidays and contest winners.
But what's the difference?
It's actually a lot harder than it used to be.
I think you guys should actually have a Flophouse calendar.
This is the truth, with
your months and like pictures of like, it's like, okay, and here's February with, you know, like, you're like Elliot eating Popeyes and, you know.
Isn't every holiday a made-up holiday?
That's true.
I mean, think of any holiday that isn't really made up. And usually it's a made-up holiday on top of someone else's made-up holiday.
That's true.
Yep.
But now we've got, I mean, yeah, these days we've got Cagemas. So at Christmas we watch a Nicolas Cage movie. We've got Cagemas in July.
Eight?
We also watch a Cage movie. We've got Shocktober.
Small
in October, where it's all horror movies. Oh, yeah, and before that, in September, we've got Small Temper, where we just watch.
The vast Soviet arsenal. Nothing was more profitable than Optimat Kalashnikova, model of 1947,
what is
more
this?
Commonly known as the AK-47 or Kalashnikov. It's the world's most popular assault rifle.
Wait, is this
a weapon
Lords of War?
An elegantly simple 9-pound amalgamation.
It's actually probably the best part of the movie.
It doesn't break, jam, or overheat. It will shoot whether it's covered.
I'm so glad I have this loaded.
It's so easy, even a child can use it, and they do. The Soviets put the gun on a coin. Mozambique put it on their flag.
It's a little long, but
since the end of the Cold War, the Kalashnikov has become the Russian people's greatest export. After that comes vodka, caviar, and suicidal novelists. One thing's for sure. No one was lining up to buy their cars.
And the thing, I'm sitting here transfixed. The thing is, like, the internet has turned Nicolas Cage into this, like, weird joke, and mm-hmm. And I feel like, I feel weird that we're
perpetuating
sort of part of that, yeah, because like our appreciation of Nicolas Cage is not entirely ironic. Like, we know that he makes a bunch of terrible movies, but we also think he's a really good actor.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I'm with you.
He just takes any script that just like falls on his desk.
Yeah.
Well, I love, even when, I mean, he'll take those risks that, mm-hmm. you know, not every actor will take, and that, you know, that will either. He'll fail brilliantly, or he'll succeed brilliantly. So.
Yeah, that's why his bad movies are so much fun. You know, like yeah. a bad actor in a bad movie is just boring.
Yeah. Right,
but he's always funny.
He's going for he's like Depp in that way.
Yeah,
true.
I mean, let's face it, Depp has done a lot of shit.
Yeah,
I love him too, but he's done it. There's a lot of stink burgers in there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, we did Mordecai, which was quite an experience.
I actually
Mustache the movie.
There you go. It's so funny too. There's a one point where we're talking about movies and I'm just like, and this is what you do. You know, this is your show.
Yeah.
This could be your show. This could be an episode from your show.
That's right.
All right, kids, that's our first entry. We did two cuts for our first entry. We rarely do that on Casey Kasem's Top 10 of 2016. Blah, blah, blah. Hey, all right, so...
Are you going to do, like, the angry Casey, like, when he gets all mad?
Oh, our little dog, Snuckles, gotta go into a goddamn death dedication when somebody's fucking dog died! Is my agent on the phone? Get me my agent! Is Don on the line? And you tell him that I'm supposed to see the pictures that I'm supposed to see! I know way too much of that without
That's
even
so
seeing.
Funny.
I got it more. You really lock into it more after you podcast it
yes,
a few times.
So funny. You're making me, my eyes are watering over here.
All right. Coming in next moment okay. for the show. Well, during the year, because of the movie, the documentary again, I got to take a trip up to Canada.
Ooh, yes.
And while up there, we filmed with Scott Thompson, the great.
Wonderful.
Actor from Kids in the Hall yes. and from the Larry Sanders Show.
Brain Candy.
Yeah. So while up there, I hung out with Dave Mader. Now, I don't have any footage of that. What I have, if you go to episode 3-17, mm-hmm. we have on Dave Mader, who I stayed with. And we did this show a few months after, so we're talking in retrospect. But you know, here is a little bit about the trip up to Canada with Dave Mader as our guest from show 3-17.
I know. Well, I remember when Scott Thompson was like, "Hey, why
I
are
couldn't
you
take
are
it you, back."
Are you like the EP or something? I was like, "No, I'm the only guy in Canada Scott knows." So,
he's the only guy who put up with me.
Somebody's got to drive him around. And,
I'm a chauffeur.
But it was awesome, dude. I loved having you there. It was so much fun.
No.
And you were kind of part of the crew. I mean, if anything, you were the mingler.
I was the mingler.
You were the local.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah, well, because we had the camera lady that we had recruited from my
alma mater.
Dude, you took me to my first official poutine.
Oh, my God.
I did. That's right. Yeah, I took you to Kurtz.
And that was awesome. I still have dreams of it.
Yeah, that was... Which one did you get? I can't remember.
I got the classic or whatever.
You got the classic.
And you know what? I get it. I get why the curds sort of work better than just regular mozzarella cheese.
Well, that's not real.
They do.
Yeah, I know. But, you know.
Oh, I'm on some.
A substitute. Good. Around here, you go cheese curds. Everyone looks at you like, what, you have a shit? What's going on?
It used to be like that in Ontario, too. Like, it used to be if you wanted to get good poutine, you had to go to, like, Quebec.
Oh, wow. He's putting the right
poutine.
Yeah.
Well, that was one of the things that drove me nuts about Tusk was that Johnny Depp says poutine like an English guy. And French people don't say it like that. They say poutine. But, you know, not.
Quebecois.
He was very.
Separatist.
He was very, like, over the top.
Right.
Where's Triumph the Insult Comic Dog when you need him?
And so Ontario, I guess enough Quebecers, like, or left. Quebec came to Ontario, so Ontario started doing poutine right and up like in places. So now you can get decent curds and things like that in your poutine now, and it's good.
There you go. I pulled the poutine clip. I knew there was some reason I pulled that one, too.
The word curd, though, doesn't sound like you should be eating
That's
it.
What I said. Sounds like you should be taking a shit or something.
I know. It's like curd.
You were just for the record, Jean was cracking
that
up like
so
she never
funny.
Heard that before.
Yeah. Well, you forget it. And when you're in the moment in the podcast, you
I
forget.
Might have to leave the mics on just so we can hear some
it's
reaction
so
from us.
Funny.
I just don't want it to be too confusing.
Oh, and I want to go to Canada.
I don't want to be. See, that was, it was, you know, like in, for people who don't travel a lot, we traveled, you know, twice in a year.
Yeah.
Or at least I did.
Yeah.
And
well,
big trips.
And there'll be a time
not
when
little
we can
trips.
Both. It's just like there's like
yeah.
when work isn't involved.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, even
and
when
money
you see
and
Kev,
everything else.
Like Jen's not always with him. Harley, yep. You know what I mean? Like people have to kind of do their own thing.
Yes.
But what an amazing story is when you came back. Like that's what I like. I'm like chomping at the bit for you to come home to tell me all about it because it's awesome.
And Dave was
and
a really cool guy.
And Scott Thompson and how cool it is and how wonderful Dave was to bring you around.
And also, you know who else I met while I was up there?
Midnight Smoke.
Yes. So, yeah.
Another awesome guy. And I met him too this summer. It was awesome.
Yes. All right. Well, we'll get to that.
Yes,
that comes later. That comes
that's
later.
I'm getting all excited.
We're building up.
We're building up.
All right. Coming in. What are we up to already? So, we did two clips for number 10, then we did number 9. Now we're at number 8. Now, number 8
on
was.
On countdown.
On our top 10 countdown moments of 2016 for That Man on Fat Man.
That's a long distance one.
Yeah. Well, not that long distance. The next person was someone we met via, also through the movie, but also kind of through Jiggy.
Ooh.
That's right. You already know who it is. So we were recording a show for Jiggy and John. And John, his podcasting partner, has a working relationship with none other than Raquel Castro.
Oh, my gosh. Jersey
who
girl
is
herself.
The Jersey Girl. If Kevin's movie Jersey Girl, the young lady in it, is Raquel Castro. So
it was crazy how it happened.
Yeah.
She just happened to be there as their guest on their live Jiggy and John podcast.
Yep. And then we met her. We introduced her. We told her, like, oh, my God, we have to do a show.
Yeah.
And
she was on board right away.
Yeah,
and she's so cute. She's, like, 4 feet tall. I was wearing, like, these, like insane, like 10-inch heels.
Yeah. And
so
since then,
cute.
She's been on The Voice. Uh-huh. She was on Empire.
Yes.
And, yeah, so she's
and
been.
And she's been doing a lot of,
performing.
A lot of voice.
Yes.
That's, very. I think she's very, very much into writing now, too. So that's her thing.
Yes. So here is a little clip from the show with 3-21, Raquel Castro.
My first question to you is, do you recall when you were working
opposite Mr. Ben Affleck, what the name of the vehicle was called at the time?
Oh my God, the street sweeper, but yeah. it's the Batmobile.
Yeah.
We called it.
So how ironic was it that, you know, you were riding around in the Batmobile with Batman?
I swear it was so funny because I think I saw Kevin tweet out like something and he was like, we called it in Jersey Girl. And I was like, wow, that's actually so true. Like that just makes it like even more dope that he's doing it. So, and I was so happy for him. Like he really, really deserves that. And all of his success, it's incredible. So, and to be able to work with him before he was actually really riding the real Batmobile, that's even cooler.
It is.
So how old were you when your Jersey Girl experience started? Do you recall?
I think I auditioned when I was 6 years old and I started filming when I was 7. So it was kind of like that, like the transition from 6 to 7 is kind of when this whole thing started. And I was doing publicity for it first in the U.S. and then I was doing publicity till I was about like 10, I'd say like 10 or 11 years old. Wow. We did Japan. We did London. Wow. It was just such an incredible experience.
You know, first I want to say my wife and you share a birthday.
Oh my gosh. We have the same birthday, oh, November 17th.
Oh my gosh, Scorpio power.
I know. Love Scorpio.
I love meeting other Scorpios. It's like my favorite thing in the world.
So many people that I don't know. There's so many people in my life are Scorpios though. It just
Do you know who else is November 17th?
Who?
Rachel McAdams, who's one of my favorite actresses.
Oh, wow.
And Danny DeVito is November 17th. Yep.
Well,
so we share birthdays with some cool people.
We do.
Well, 17 is huge in our family because, first of all, Gene's mother is also 11/17.
Yeah.
Now, oh, I love it. That's my favorite time, too. Whenever I look at the clock and I see 11/17, I'm like, okay, making a wish instead of 11/11. Yeah. It's 11/17.
Our son was born on
7/17. Our daughter is 2/17.
Yep.
And you're April 30th.
Yeah, I'm the oddball.
You don't even fit in. You don't fit into it.
Nope. No, it's okay. Yeah, it's my favorite number, though. It's such a great number.
It is.
I left in all that female chit-chat. That was
great?
So inane.
So cute.
Women just fucking, like, talk about
Scorpio
bullshit.
Scorpio women rock. I'm just telling you. If you know a Scorpio woman,
I've never heard such fakeness.
That's not fake. They're passionate. They're like loving. All right. Like insanely awesome.
All righty.
So if you're a Scorpio woman, you rock.
Okay. So you say.
Yes, I say. Because I am one.
Okay.
I know these things. She's adorable. That was a great show.
All right. Coming in at number 7. Number 7. Are we on number 7? Right? Dan was 10. Canada was 9.
We're on number
7. Raquel was 8. We're down to 7. All right. Well, I'm actually switching to, I think. But it doesn't really matter. It's not all that big a deal. But if you recall, during our filming career this year, we found out that another podcaster had a moment with Paul McCartney.
Yes.
Because we were in the Colbert, we got to see Colbert, and when we were on Colbert, the guest was Paul McCartney. Well, as it turns out, someone asked Paul McCartney to be on the show that day, and he said yes.
Isn't that crazy?
And that was Paul Mercurio.
I know, on that day that we were there.
Yeah. So we thought that was amazing when we found out that story.
I still do.
we sought out Paul Mercurio with much gusto. I mean, we knew who he was. I knew he was a warm-up guy for The Daily Show at one point because I'd seen him warm up for The Daily Show. He's talked about it in the book, too, because he was one of the first writing staff on The Daily Show as well. So we sat down. We interviewed him for the film. And then a couple weeks later, he joined us on the show. And here is a little bit of our clip from 3-23. With Paul Mercurio.
Look, there definitely, it wouldn't hurt to have a true outsider run the country for a while. So, but that person has to be a bit humble if they want my vote and just say, look, I know I don't know everything and I know a lot about this, but I don't know much about this, but the thing I don't know much about, I'm going to learn, I'm going to have advisors, whatever. I'm like, all right, this guy's cool, I'll give him a shot. he understands that it's an important job and he needs to be well educated in the nuances of it. But this fucking asshole won't admit that he doesn't know anything.
I am so glad you brought this up.
And then flaunts it. And that's why I would never vote for him. Not because he's an outsider, not because he's a billionaire, not because he's even arrogant. It's because he's so arrogant that he won't admit that he doesn't know anything. And I analogize it to like if you get you got racked up in a motorcycle accident, they wheeled you in an emergency room and you're all cut open. And this doctor's standing there like he's Trump, basically, like the doctor's like, what's all this red stuff in the body? Well, that's blood and veins, doctor. What is that thing that's moving in the body? That's the heart. What does the heart do? Well, you know, why are you attacking me? Are you the liberal media? Are you Muslim? Why are you picking on me that I don't know the human body? What is wrong with you? And he diverts it back to the people. And I think, you know, it's like we finally got a guy who can get America's bra off, an outsider, and he doesn't know what to do with the tits. Like, it's just fucking ridiculous.
Oh, what a clip. it's so great, too. And that was recorded before the man became president, but he nailed it. We got a president who knows how to get a bra off, but doesn't know what to do with the tits.
But he knows what to do with the pussy.
Oh, yeah, we all know he knows what to... What does he know? What? Are you telling me? Huh? What? He knows how to... What? What? What are you saying? He knows how to...
Grab him by the pussy.
I had to make it there over to go. The soundbite. Could you tell I was stalling?
At least he knows how to do something. Jeez.
I moved on her, actually.
Of course he did. That's what he does.
Like, I did try and her. She was married. I moved on her, and I failed.
How did you actually move on her, sir?
I moved on her like a bitch. But I couldn't get there, and she was married.
Like a bitch.
I just like what on her. Well, I don't want to. Another comedian we had on another podcast recently had some great insight.
Oh,
and they said, you could do a dissertation on just that one line, and I totally agree.
Yes.
Of like the history of... You know, male privilege and, you know, I came at her like a bitch.
Yeah, and there's so many different ways you can interpret that.
Yes. Well,
I
think there's only one.
No.
Yeah, he was saying that he was in a low position. He was a bitch.
Right.
He was a one down. He did not have his game on.
Yeah.
And all right, let's not get too deep. Loved what Paul Mercurio added to the discussion there. That was a good cut. There was some other great stuff in that interview.
Oh, that's a great interview.
That's a good show.
So check out the whole thing.
Yeah. If you get a chance, you won't be disappointed. Once again, that episode is 3-23 with Paul Mercurio.
Yep.
All right.
And his podcast is great, too. He's got a great podcast.
Coming in at number 6. That's right. Number 6. We have... This was a real, just an amazing moment because other than Kevin, I don't think we've had this big a director on the show.
Oh.
And, but that's not how he started in showbiz. He got his start on effects.
Oh, yes.
And if you go to this person's IMDb page, they have a list of credits as long as you're fucking arm, as long as Liam Neeson's cock long.
Wow.
And chances are at least one or two of your favorite movies is on that list because it's just amazing.
Oh, yeah, at least.
And so without further ado, this is from show. This is show 3-12 with Robert Kurtzman.
So he steps to you and says, I got this weird sort of thing.
Yeah, he sent me the script, which is, you know, was one of the weirdest things I've ever read. It was kind of like reading Bubba Hotep for the first time.
Yeah. Did you know that it had been based on a podcast?
No, not initially. Then I found out, you know, kind of the history of it, you know, after the fact.
Yeah.
I mean, it says it on the script, but, you know, I'd never heard the podcast.
Yeah.
And, you know, he sent me the script and I read the breakdown and then I kind of went, you know, we had a couple of quick meetings about the look of the thing, you know, and it was kind of nice because I hit it off with him pretty quickly as far as creatively and stuff, you know. I think we grew up on the same films and it had kind of came up in the business with the same filmmakers like Quentin and Robert and Rodriguez and him and, you know, that indie crowd that came up at that time. And
Let me interrupt because you were right in there because of Dust Till Dawn. I mean, let's face it.
Well, that and Reservoir Dogs and all the early stuff we were doing, especially with not just those filmmakers, but like other filmmakers, and some of them were having, you know, a second career. Like John Carpenter was on his like second phase of making movies when we got involved. We grew up on his stuff.
You were involved in a movie that, when I'm in a down mood, if I put that movie on, it never fails to disappoint me, and that's Army of Darkness.
Yeah, that's one of the all-time favorite experiences, one of mine. That and Evil Dead 2, of course, but and it was, you know, working with Sam and Bruce and all those guys again, and it was like the little family back together again on that film, and and because of the what was in the movie with all the skeletons, yeah, and, you know, the dad and the horseback and
the Harryhausen thing.
Yeah, you know, for us it was like we were big kids. You know, we were like, oh, we get to blow up shit on a real castle set. You know? this is cool.
I grew up on all the. I mean, I'm the same age as Kevin, so I was born in 1970, so I have a lot of the same touchstones. So, and there you have it. That was Robert Kurtzman, and
that was amazing.
Yeah, what I think I want to add to that is for those people who follow the show regularly. Within a few weeks, actually, of having him on, our son had an accident with mm-hmm. the lawnmower,
yeah,
and ended up losing the tips of two of his fingers. Mm-hmm. And just the way things shook out, we made an inside reference between us about Game of Thrones and mm-hmm. the Onion Knight. And long story short, Robert Kurtzman actually produced a little like bag with fake finger bones in it.
Onion Knight bones.
And an Onion Knight seal on the bag,
yeah,
as a you know, just a well wish. Yeah, we asked him to do it, but they had no reason to do it.
It was a beautiful gesture.
And yeah,
he actually put a little note in there saying, you know, best wishes, Onion Knight.
Yeah, it was really cool.
And Cameron,
he didn't have to do that.
And Cameron was touched, and he's an amazing kid, and he's just really, he's doing well. And it was just like something that he didn't have to do. He doesn't even know us. He was just a really nice.
Yeah, and we're
child.
Looking to get him back in here this year, 2017, and so we can talk about, because we talked about Tusk. That's
and
what
we
that
were
was
so
being
very close to even maybe even meeting him.
Yeah.
Tusk premiere in Red Bank. That was a cool experience.
That was a crazy day.
Crazy day. But that was an awesome show.
Yes. So there you go.
Thank you, Mr.
Wow, we're getting through these faster than I thought. Much faster than last year. A couple of them are long. We're getting there, though.
Okay.
So now we're at number five. Coming in at number five. We're at halfway already. Hang on. One, two.
Coming in on number five on the countdown.
Okay. This was a big moment for the show. This is from earlier in the year. It's like we're kind of going back. This is from show 3-8, when after we filmed Keith and the Girl, we then sat down and podcasted in their studio.
Oh, that's right, because that was the beginning of the year.
Yeah, and we were very out of sorts, so we weren't in our element. And next thing you know, this happened.
Can I point out something totally different really
sure.
quick? How hot is your wife?
Totally hot.
What is going on?
Wow, that's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yes. You're saying about me? You're so sweet.
So you're just sitting there oogling my wife. Is that what's going on here?
Mm-hmm. I was going to say hot as fuck. I didn't know if it was my place.
You guys are super
nice. I'm a lucky guy.
This is like the best place ever.
Oh, I'm not done. I mean smoking.
Oh, you want to hear something even better?
Yeah.
She's a total out of the closet bisexual.
Oh,
ooh, she could cheat on you at any moment. Just kidding.
Do you want to take a trip to Europe, or was it?
This is so funny. Only like straight guys would be like, you know what's great? She doesn't care.
Oh, that's okay, because I'm not straight. I'm bisexual also.
Oh, really? Yeah. Oh, that's fun.
We're both openly bi.
We're both bi.
That's so fun. But does that apply at all once you're together?
Like, do you guys?
Oh, well, can or can't?
Yeah, I can.
Oh, so
yeah,
do you guys have an open marriage?
Yes, we do.
Oh,
I think
then how
is more
fun
open.
Is that?
And this is the first time we've actually ever said it on a recording. I might have to clip it out.
Oh,
well,
Keith, you want to hear something fun?
That we're recording it also, and you guys can email me.
But no, seriously, this is the first time this has ever come up.
Well, no, okay, I mean, we talked about bisexual before, but no one's ever asked us the obvious.
The
hey,
then.
You guys open?
Well, I mean, it's like, why would you be excited about being bisexual when you're in a monogamous relationship?
Right, like, how are you taking care of
it? Doesn't make you
that,
any less bisexual
or, yeah,
if you're in a monogamous relationship.
Oh, then
yes,
I'm bisexual too.
Oh,
no! Why not? Me and my wife, we're just monogamous. The things I do.
Isn't it about, like, where you've been and who you're turned on by? And
you
what
tell
you
me.
Like? I mean, that's what I think. Believe me, I know they're kidding. I've heard their show.
Yeah. We pretty much know.
Who's the last person to, experiment? Who's the last person to go out and enjoy life?
Wow.
Well, we were just on a date last night with another couple, so
really,
you could say
we were just on a date.
But actually, we didn't go there yet. It was just a date.
It was just a date. The swapping didn't happen.
No.
We hate that shit.
The word swapping, like, what's the?
We hate all the fucking 70s.
What word do I use?
Swinging, swap.
What do I use though?
Well, isn't it an open relationship?
Yeah, exactly. Sorry about that. Yeah, we're back. Hey, so there.
See, Keith was trying to say, you need to show us what to say. You need to guide us what to say. We don't know what to say.
Oh, yeah, right. He doesn't know what to say.
Keith always knows what to say.
Yeah. It was,
that's a great show.
We were just saying that there are a lot of vernacular. And if,
yeah.
Well, hang on. Everything sort of leads to something else.
Yes.
So, before we go too much further down that path, there'll be plenty of time to talk about this. Let's play the next clip.
Okay.
Which is... what are we at now? I keep losing my place here.
Four.
Are we on four? It might be. Let's hang on. We can go through the review. We had Dan McCoy was coming in at number 10.
Okay.
Our show with him. Then Off to Canada was number 9.
Yes.
We sat down with Raquel Castro for number 8. Number 7 was Paul Mercurio.
Yes.
Number 6, Robert Kurtzman. Number 5, our time on the Keith and the Girl show.
Yes.
Now number 4. Was very recently, and this all had to do with anyone who's followed the show knows that, you know, I've been supporting a film called Shooting Clerks.
Right.
And along the way, I got to cameo in it. I got to be an extra. I got to stand in for Kevin. And then finally, the last thing that happened on it was they asked me to play Howard Stern.
I know, right?
In a little tiny cameo. And so, this year that movie was released. It was released a couple months ago. They did some film festivals. They've won some awards, and it's just been a major highlight of the year. And
yes, it's been a joy of 2016.
Yeah. And not too long ago, we had on Bob Hawke and Chris Bain.
And his crush, yes. Yeah,
and we did two shows, it's 3:30 and 3-31.
Yeah.
This particular cut is from 3-30. This is Bob's review of that film, and it's the longer one, the less cut one.
So Enjoy it.
Here's Bob's review of Shooting Clerks coming in at number 4.
I was amazed at what Shooting Clerks turned out to be, which was a very affectionate, even subtle film.
Really?
That was a real homage to the spirit of Clerks. And it had an amazing sensibility, and sensitivity is, I mean, for anyone who knows Clerks is going to be a feast, but it's really, I didn't expect anything as complex or subtle.
It
is very entertaining.
So you're saying it's not a bunch of gags strung together.
But it isn't trying to hit you over the head.
Yeah.
It's really a tribute to what I have learned is Kevin Smith and his spirit.
Yeah. All right, there you go. That was Bob's review.
I totally agree.
Yeah, definitely.
Absolutely. So much love in that movie.
All right, here we go.
I like that. That was really nice.
Yes, I agree. And thank you, Bob. And you were a great guest this year.
And we miss you.
Yeah, we always love having him.
Happy New Year.
Yeah, he's a great friend of the show. And
yeah, we usually like do a thing in the city maybe around this time, so we'll have to kind of get with him soon.
Yeah. All right, so now the next one is a little bit of a controversy. Coming in at number three, I had a hard time.
Mm. A controversy, like, within yourself?
Yeah. So, the only way I could do it properly,
okay,
it's a tie.
Oh, we have a tie.
We have a tie for number three. I couldn't figure out any way to do it. Okay. So, and they're sort of both the results of clips you've heard earlier. Now, so for this first one in the number three position, the first clip that is tied for number three is from show 332.
Okay.
And the reason why I think it was a big event for us is Gene and I started a second show. And based on, essentially, what, you know, Hemda and Keith, yeah, sort of released, and that's a show called Tales from the Swing, right, which is the name of the episode 3-32. And so here is a cut. I mean, we decided to get open and own it. And
that was huge for 2016, too, for
huge
us.
And you know what? I love that show. There's only a few there. We started not too long before the holidays, right, so... You know, it's fits and starts.
Yeah.
But, you know, as this year progresses, you will see more of those shows come out. Yeah. And
it feels right.
Yeah. I think it was a good thing for us. I think it will be a good thing for us. And it allows us to help others.
It feels right.
Yeah. It just feels right. So yeah, here is from the tied for number three, the first, you know, runner up is show 332, Tales from the Swing.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Tales from the Swing. My name is Jean Holden.
And I'm Scott Holden. And welcome to the Zero Edition, where we're going to kind of give you a thumbnail sketch of what the show is, why we're hosting it, and what you have to look forward to.
Yeah.
And I think the first part would be, all right, who are we, and why would we want to do this? Well, Jean and I host another podcast, which, mm-hmm, is, you know, has its own... Mm-hmm. Cult success status, I would say. You know, we.
It's a fanboy show.
Yeah, and it's brightened our lives.
It has.
It's gotten us a lot of exposure to you know, people that we never would have met before,
right,
and just a lot of really cool experiences. And through that, you know, something happens when you podcast, and you tend to reveal yourself more and more. And get it more and more honest. And the mics are like truth serum. So,
oh my gosh, yes.
You know, as a course of the show, we've managed to open up about ourselves and our sexuality and our lifestyle. And essentially, you know, we are an openly bisexual married couple. And our relationship is probably what you would say is in the open spectrum.
Right.
Now, quickly, we want to address this because... While the title of the show is called Tales from the Swing, what was usually referred to as the swinging community,
yeah,
and still many people refer to it as such, is definitely a community in transition.
Right.
Many of the terms like swing and, you know, swap. And all, those are starting to fall by the wayside.
Swinging and swapping.
Very misogynistic. Yeah. A lot of people, even in the community, are becoming sort of repulsed by them.
Yeah.
And what they imply.
Well, because there's something you think of when you hear that.
Yeah.
That it's not necessarily what's happening.
So, but we want to address, we see it as open.
Right.
But, you know, people use the term swing, people use the term for, polyamory.
Right.
Open. These are all different, really, words.
And they're all valid.
For what are essentially open relationships.
What a relationship is like.
Which is, on some level, you know, a relationship with multiple partners at some time or another.
Yes.
So we're going to keep a more loose definition of what we mean by that. So if you're a swinger, if you think of yourself as a swinger, or you think of yourself as polyamorous, we don't want to get too bogged down in that kind of shit.
Right. We're not here to label you.
Yeah, we're here to talk about the things that you know, we find humorous and,
right,
you know, what we find interesting and just, you know,
and what we like.
And entertaining in this lifestyle, which you'll hear a lot too.
The lifestyle
is another term that gets thrown around a lot.
Right.
There you go. Hey, my mic was open the whole time. I was good at being quiet.
I wasn't, was I?
No, you're fine. Your mic was off.
I was doing goofy stuff.
You know what? Now, That was the one tie. But before we move on,
okay,
I think it's a good time to just hear a little bit from the people that pay the bills.
Okay.
All right, we want to take a moment to talk about Death Wish Coffee. That's right. Ladies and gentlemen, do yourself a favor and get over to deathwishcoffee.com. And there you can buy the strongest coffee known to man without a prescription.
The world's strongest coffee ever.
Yes, as proudly displayed on my wife's sweatshirt over there.
Yes, on my body, yes. On my mug.
Yes,
on my K-cups.
Yes, and you'll know them by their telling sign of the skull and crossbones.
That tells
you
good.
Exactly what you're in for. It's that used to be the international symbol for poison, but now it is the symbol for good damn coffee.
That's awesome. Without milk, with milk, you don't really need it because it's strong.
But not bitter?
Not bitter. So you don't even need milk. You don't even need sugar, but you can add it if you'd like. It's just really, really the perfect, strongest, most awesome coffee.
Become a junkie of Death Wish, just like the Anderson Council.
And oh, we got them hooked.
Again, deathwishcoffee.com. Thank you very
Enjoy
much.
Enjoy it.
I want to take this time to mention to you www.audibletrial.com/ThatManOnFatMan. That's right, www.audibletrial.com/ThatManOnFatMan. That's one word conjunctified. Go there. Sign up for your free 30-day free trial. Sign up. Get a free book, a free audio book, because you don't have to go through no tedious reading. You don't have to turn no fucking pages. You don't have to do any of that bullshit. You get in your car, you put on your headphones, and you are listening to a book. You're taking a magical journey into a fictitious land. You're expanding your mind all when you're stuck in traffic. Fucking amazing. Audiobooks. These are the wave of the future. And you can get in for free for 30 days. A free trial. And when you get your free trial, you can download a copy of Tough Shit by our savior, Kevin Smith. That's right. Our Lord and Savior, Kevin Smith, has left words for us to follow in our lives. And we can get it for free just by signing up to audibletrial.com/ThatManOnFatMan. That's right. audibletrial.com/ThatManOnFatMan. Thank you. Please sign up. You'll be very happy you did. All right. There's our commercial spots out of the way.
Yeah, speaking of Audible, you just told me that you got Carrie Fisher's new book.
Yeah, I did. I haven't heard it yet.
It was a little.
I listened to a little bit of it. And I was already like, ooh.
Yeah, because it's her reading it.
It's
just
a little too.
I'm interested in that.
Fresh.
I know that.
This week I'll listen to it.
Our friend, Big Daddy, back at Talk, Big Daddy Jimmy V, they were just on holiday, and Maren was listening to it. She was actually reading it on the plane. So it's something that people are reading and, you know, getting in touch with.
Yeah. And she was on Colbert not too long ago, too. Yeah. So it's so weird.
There's a lot about her that I didn't know. But, check it out on Audible.
I mean, I was getting ready to do a Bone Crushing Juggernaut, a BCJ show. And then they announced she died. And I was like, it took me another couple of hours to get myself to get, I mean, not like I broke down, but it was just so weird.
Yeah,
I was like,
you're just out of sorts.
And I was also like, I guess that changed the whole fucking show I was about to do.
Yeah. Isn't it amazing, though, how that could just change?
She's an amazing person. She's much funnier than people knew.
She was an advocate for mental illness I never knew.
And for addiction.
And so much addiction.
For struggles and stuff. Yeah,
and she, people have, so if you, like, there's so much that you may relate with her. So check out her book. You might find out more about her.
Yes. I have not read it yet, but...
Yeah, I do want to. It's going to take me a little bit of time, but I think I'm going to do what you said in the commercial and stick my headphones in and listen to it on the way to work.
There you go.
That sounds like a good idea.
All right, so... All right, let's get back now.
Okay, we're back.
We're at number three. We're tied. Okay. We played our first clip, which was from Tales from the Swing. Now, this next cut is a little long, but it's worth every penny. And it ties into, I mean, this came about because of the fact that this year, I'm playing Howard in a film. And so it got me to thinking about how much I enjoyed Howard and how much he was an influence in my life. And then I went looking for a tape of some footage where a certain pair that host this show were actually on Howard Stern back
now,
in the early 90s.
And tape, we mean cassette tape.
Yes, so... so we found this old tape and we played the whole segment on the show. There was other stuff on the show too, but I pulled this cut. It's a little on the long side, but it is worth every moment. And so I'm going to mute us. And tied for number three from show 3-26, a Howard Stern retrospective.
That was good?
Oh.
I don't want to get too hard here. That was good?
Oh my god. Why am I so
how's that?
Like vocal?
Moaning.
Too hard?
No, like that. Too hard.
Oh god, you're so hot.
Oh, man. Where were you when I was where
I'm
were
in the
you?
Green room again.
Oh, you were missing the whole thing.
Of course.
You like that?
Why?
Is that enough?
It would have made it weird if I was there, I think. Cuckoldy, I guess.
Yeah, it wasn't
wait a minute.
Weird.
You got 21 today. You've only done five.
It wasn't weird
it's
anyway.
Getting a little weird. Whoa.
For those really listening to the best of episode, wow. Gene is getting birthday
more?
Spankings
am I doing it too hard?
From Howard.
No. Oh, okay.
Just to give you context. That was a laugh.
How many is that, Robin?
That's, I think, 11, 12.
That's all?
Like 10 more.
10 more. Here we go. Ready?
10 in a row.
10 in a row.
10 in a row. Give it to me. Hit me with your shoe.
That's not hard.
All right, all right. Yeah, I take off two. I didn't do it.
It's so good that you did that, though.
Take off
like,
two.
You really put him off.
How's
one
that?
One more.
One more?
One more.
Oh, my God.
How's that?
Very good.
Oh, wow. Let me get out my lotion. I think I just came.
Really? Four?
We'll make it one good one.
All right, one good
this
one?
This is the funny one.
Really?
Really hard.
I think she's really digging me. You're really digging me, aren't you?
Mm-hmm. Well, you might as well go for it, Howard.
Well, I...
So funny.
All right, one more.
Fred.
This is the last time I'm ever doing this again.
Yeah,
you ready?
Might as well get a good one in.
All right, here we go.
Is it hard?
What?
Is it hard?
All right, take it easy. All right, here we go. You ready?
Fuck me, God damn it.
How's that?
That wasn't hard at all. Howard, you're not doing it right.
I can't do it any harder. My hand hurts.
That was nice.
All right.
God, you are...
All right.
You are playing it up big time.
I am.
And as a, speaking as a man of Howard's age at around this time,
yeah, she's there for the
I have a fucking hard on, so...
No, a woman on your
I might have to do the whole show like this.
He hopes so.
You don't want to get up, do you? What?
Yeah. You're still just as hot, though. That's the funny thing.
Oh, thank you.
You're just a little more...
No, that's enough. You've had enough.
Yeah, a little...
I've had enough.
Keep it in your wraps.
So. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I'm not like that anymore.
You weren't the young...
She had fun, I'm telling you. You're welcome. This show's getting too weird.
No, you...
Ever since we got on in Los Angeles... I'm not doing this anymore. That's it. It's over with. No more. I don't need this.
I don't. I agree with you 100%.
I'm sorry, what? Okay. Oh, well, there you are.
The irony.
Why aren't you
going to
do it anymore?
Because, what?
Should I cancel the one for next Wednesday?
We got one for next Wednesday?
No, cancel it.
What's the story? Is she really in bad shape? And what do you mean? She said she really wants to get spanked
really
by you. She's 25
shape.
Years old, redhead.
You do this again. Mm-hmm. We're
100%.
Back I'm sorry, what? Oh, well, there you are.
Why aren't you going to do it anymore?
Because, what?
Can I cancel the one for next Wednesday?
We got one for next Wednesday?
No, cancel it.
What's her story? Is she really in bad shape?
She's in bad shape. That is so funny.
She said she really wants to get spanked by you. She's 25 years old, redhead, very pretty.
Does she need my services?
Well, she's very pretty, and she's a redhead. You're kind of a redhead, aren't you? Well, brown.
No, I'm not a redhead.
Brown is
not
red.
That time.
It's like an Auburn
kind of.
It's like
you
an
really
Auburn kind of.
Really made your life. And get on that microphone. I've got to do a post.
Made your life.
Find out how it was for you.
It didn't make your life, did it?
Well, that was good for me, too. I'll tell you the truth.
Yeah.
It's
certainly given us some content.
Stop doing it
it's given us like 20 minutes of filler. It's probably blowing people's minds.
Put that microphone in front of you.
They're seeing the young, sexually experimental side.
Yeah, the next request might be
young.
Where's your boyfriend?
Extraordinary.
Let me meet him. I got to
see
him.
Yeah, let's see how he felt about it.
Here comes this whiz kid.
He likes that.
Had to leave this in.
Junior.
Yeah. It's pretty wild.
Junior stud muffin coming in.
You can spank him, Robin.
Okay. I'll whap him around.
Whap him around a few times. I did it hard enough for you? Yeah?
Hard enough.
Okay. Now, here's your boyfriend. Now, let me meet him. Now, he's a good-looking guy. You're a much better-looking guy than I am. Is he better-looking than I am?
Hey, Howard.
Hey, dude.
In that Abe Lincoln sort of way. Yeah.
I was 21.
Oh, you're a real big fan, huh? Want me to spank you too, Junior?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Really?
Yeah. Line him up.
You got some girlfriend here, man.
What an idiot. Line him up. Yeah, what the fuck are they talking about?
As soon as she gets in on one of the women for you.
Yeah.
What a dick.
I guess you're in love.
What a dick.
You better get married. You want to marry him or
a dick
what?
In denial.
Someday, yes.
Ooh. He loved it.
He's my prince, charming.
You marry her someday?
Yeah, I'd love to.
Really?
Yeah.
This is a couple of idiots. So
you
clueless.
You spank her, huh?
Yeah.
She asked you to, or you just do it?
Yeah, she asked me to.
Really?
Sometimes I don't even want it.
And you have to do it.
Yeah.
Cool. Jesus. Wow. That's great.
Now, again, I want to say that comment is like so from the mouths
so
of babes.
Honest.
Like, yeah, it just came out.
But it wasn't I made like I was, you do it?
I guess at some point you must have. I don't remember us being that into spankings. And, wow. But apparently.
Yes, I was experimenting.
Yes. Well, I would assume we were because if I didn't want to do it, I got to do it.
How many times do you spank her?
It's like a chore.
Yeah, well, you know.
Like a leather glove? Smell the glove, Gene.
What, swingers or something?
Not really.
The irony.
Me and Gary are available to swing with you two guys.
That's your couple, you and Gary?
Me and Gary.
Gary.
Gary really swings. You should have seen him in the beauty shop yesterday. Baba Booey.
Hey, we got a Baba Booey.
You don't even mind the other guys spanking her, huh?
No, not at all. That's all for you, Howard.
Wait a minute.
See, here we go.
Do you have another guy over for her?
I don't know about that one.
Yeah. He knows what he's doing.
Liberated.
What is that?
I've asked him.
I was that dick.
No.
I was that dick.
Guys got to stop at some point.
There's got to be a line drawn somewhere.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
But we didn't stay there that long, that's for sure.
Yeah?
Yeah.
No.
I mean, you'll get totally naked and let Robin spank you?
No, he won't.
Sure.
Go
for it.
No.
Well, it's nice to meet a lovely young couple like yourself. See, you know, I'm going to do Howcho instead of Groucho.
Yeah.
Now, see, they're talking about the Channel 9 show.
Yeah.
I mean, this is classic.
I know.
Howard.
Classic
period.
Howard.
It doesn't get
classic.
Any better than this.
This was
timeline
like
in my mind, yeah. Like the early '90s were shit, and
only 45
like
more
the
seconds
end
or so.
Of 1990.
Right.
Now, let's think about
it. We've, like,
now,
this pretty much met because our anniversary is coming up.
I'm trying to think. Like, you want to know what's funny? You want to know what's going on around the same time as this?
What?
Emo Kev.
Really?
Totally. Wow. It was like 89, 90 when he did that.
Yeah.
And this was like October 90 or October 91.
We were like swinging and swapping and doing crazy shit and getting on Howard.
And then he made a movie and totally eclipsed us.
Yes. And made his mark.
Yes. And then we followed around like a puppy dog ever since. And there you go. Come on, that's the second one clip coming in at number 3. Tied for number 3 on the pop charts and on the soul charts. Your little dog, Snuckles.
Little Snuckles.
Where's the goddamn pictures I'm supposed to see? Ponderous, man. Fucking ponderous. All
that
right.
Was quite a number 3.
Yes. A nice 7-minute clip, or almost 8.
I'm sure a lot of people were surprised when they heard that.
Yeah. All right. We're at number 2. And number 2 was a real easy pick. It's pretty recent. It's from show 3-33 when we had Trevor Furman. That's right. Trevor Furman, the man who plays Elias in Clerks 2.
Oh, my gosh. What a great...
Yeah.
I was so glad that he accepted the interview.
And it's just such a fun interview.
Yeah.
And he has such cool sensibilities.
Right.
Like, you could tell. And he's a geek, too.
Yeah. And I'm glad that it... I mean, it took a little bit, but I'm glad that it did because it just came at the perfect time.
Yeah. And so here's a little clip from our interview with Trevor Furman from a few weeks ago.
Yeah. Perfect. Your portrayal is adorable.
Yeah, well, thank it you. Really is.
I wanted to make, I think Kevin and I both wanted to make, I'm not a religious person and Kevin is, but he's not like a, whatever, I'll leave it at that.
Like a Bible,
I think we both wanted to make a Christian kid that like, because the character is like this hyper sheltered Christian kid.
Yeah.
I think it would have been too easy to make the caricature of that archetype like really mean spirited.
I know, right?
We wanted to avoid that.
Pillow pants.
Oh my God. When I rewatched that, I really focused on that scene and Jeff Anderson's reactions to you. Oh my God. That may be. One of the best played out scenes. The setup for Lister Fiend, the whole thing is brilliant.
That actually took us forever. I remember in rehearsal, we ran, like, our original approach was a lot more, like, weirdly lighthearted. And it just, it never felt quite right until we got to, like, the day of, and we started blocking out the scene with the cameras. And then Kevin had some weird epiphany, and he came over to me and was like, "This whole scene, just pretend that the music from The Shining is playing." And I was like, okay. All right, we'll try it that way. And it like it weirdly worked.
That's
like when we brought it to this creepy place. Like, kind of like locked in.
I would figure the best direction would be, Elias believes this. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because that's really where it was.
Yeah.
That's right. Oh, so like the disconnection between like he, and in a way, I don't know, maybe this is just the way that I thought of like it was interpreting it as I think very deep down in his heart he doesn't believe it.
Yeah, he knows.
And I think he needs it to be true.
Yes. Yes.
It's like Randall is picking up on this insane denial and like doesn't want to crack
and
his
see,
breaking.
The fact that you've thought it through that much to me is like why that character so
I know.
Works so well and why we love it.
So true.
Yes.
I love that interview. And there's so much more. We talk so much about if you're
interview.
A video game player, if
it's
you're a
interview.
D&D player. I mean, because Trevor is a gamer geek.
Yeah, he's in deep.
Unapologetic.
And
yeah, it's a great conversation.
Yeah.
So if you want to pull a great show, if you're a big fan of Clerks 2, check out 333.
And he talks about the Jay and Silent Bob game.
Yes.
Awesome.
All right. Coming in at number one. That's right. We're here. We're finally at number one.
Number one.
And it's another long clip. I made it long because I felt like it needed to be.
Yeah. I have no idea what this is. I'm surprised too, guys.
Now, this isn't exact. This is one of those clips that's really deals more. It talks about an experience more than it's the experience itself.
Okay.
And so what I've chosen is from show 3-28. And the guest is Big Daddy Jimmy V. Mm-hmm. And it's a long, talk. But I think at that part is where we start to open up. And it's the first time we really talk in some detail about not necessarily the California trip, which is a key to our whole year and why this falls in at number one. But also coming back from California and then shooting with Kevin Smith for the documentary.
Yep.
So this is sort of us relating that experience with some good detail.
Right.
To our good friend of the show, Big Daddy Jimmy V. We
and
love you.
Producer
on the movie. And so
movie,
this year, the clip from your show, Big Daddy Jimmy V, is number one. And
number
it's us
one.
Talking about our experience filming this year with Kevin Smith for the documentary. What's a podcast that we're putting together?
Yes.
Here's that clip. It's a little longer, but it's worth it.
Yeah.
But what's been going on with y'all?
Not much. A deep breather, I think, was in order for us. We, we haven't really talked to you since we interviewed Kevin since we saw you last. It was so weird. We just left LA and then we were gone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We miss it.
We do.
We really liked it. I don't know if you heard the most recent show that dropped because it had the interview with Chris Kim and we really, like, you hear it.
Yeah.
Spilling out of us because we're right there. It's still in the moment.
Right. And we didn't even get a chance to really, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
Debrief?
Well,
debrief. they did write a song about it.
I know. We did love LA. We love LA.
Oh, yes, yes.
I love LA.
We were singing it to each other.
Yeah, we actually...
We love it. We were singing it to each other.
What was it? The podcast with Susie Q a couple of shows back. We closed with that theme.
Yeah.
However, if you're on the if you listen to the YouTube version, it won't be there.
Yeah,
it gets, well, yes,
it gets pulled. But I love that. I love that. It's true because, and you know what? It says Randy. It like it is. It's very Randy.
I love LA and the red-haired lady. She's reaching for an apple. Sorry.
But no, so what's going on with the film? I mean, you were out here filming. You got the con. You got...
We came
so
back.
Much.
We came back. We... No sooner did we... I mean, you knew because we learned it while we were there that,
right.
that when we came back, we would be filming Kevin. Mm-hmm. So we came back. We filmed on the last day of Comic Men shoot. It kind of wrapped. It was a very, like... surreal and crazy experience
as
like almost all of our interactions with Kevin have been
because
originally the plan was to shoot in the Comic Book Men space. Now a couple people made that call without clearing it. And so that was the first wrinkle.
Yeah. That wasn't we didn't drop the ball on that
but
one.
It just, you know, it made things a little.
No,
rougher.
And it made you look uncomfortable in front of Kevin, which I never want that.
Well,
to
it made it made me look like, huh?
I know, like, and I wish I was there because then I would have been able to say something.
The plan was to shoot in here
because they kind of pulled Scott out from the sidewalk.
That was funny.
We were like getting ready for everything, so all we had to do was like carry everything in. And
yeah,
like, it's
we were
all
literally
ready to go.
Setting our shit up
so
on the
basically,
sidewalk as if it was a shoot.
Rob Bruce came out.
And didn't recognize us.
Didn't
at first.
Even know it was Scott. It was supposed to be Scott. He's like, "Oh my God,
He's
Scott!"
He's like, "Where's
come
the
on.
Director over here? Is there some director?"
Yeah.
And then I get, you know, I kind of like come up out of my stupor because I was.
And I'm glad
over.
It was him because he kind of
goes, "Oh, Scott, cool." I'm like, "Yeah."
And
I look like a deer in the headlights.
Yeah, I know, but I think he made it better by saying your name.
Yeah.
Because then you feel like, oh yeah, this is cool now.
Yeah.
But then you get in with Kevin, and he thinks you're.
And they shoot like down the block.
There.
They rent out a building down the block from the stash. So it changes the building. It depends on what's available and what they can get in. And so, like, we're on Broad Street, you know, with gear everywhere.
Right.
And so now it's, I'm in this thing.
And
Kevin's
AMC has their own space.
Yeah.
This is their
space.
Yeah,
it's more AMC space than it is.
Right.
View Askew.
Right.
Right.
So Kevin quickly goes, well, just stake out a space in the store. And we'll shoot there, which is fine.
Yeah, I like the spot that you picked because it's different than any other spot. Because if you were to look at other movies, you can see where you can go into the store and find where he was being shot.
One thing we didn't talk about much about this was how cool Sunday Jeff was to us.
He was so nice.
He was so awesome.
Walter was really nice too.
Yeah,
that's cool.
Yeah. But Sunday
Walter
Jeff,
cool.
I mean, because he was the only one in there because everyone else was down, you know. It was post Comic Book Men, literally. Like, they just finished shooting, and people were getting in party mode and, like, celebratory, you know, mode down in that other building.
Because they were pretty much done.
Yeah, they were done. Yeah. There was a Comic Book Men rap party that night.
Yeah.
Mm.
So it was like we were the last little thing before he had to
go.
And it was like the last minute that he had.
So he set up back at the stash, and Kevin gets, and everyone's like, "Oh, you want to get a chair?" I'm like, "No, Kevin stands."
Yeah. All he does is, and he doesn't, he just stands.
It's so funny. And I mean, because you and I, you know, we talked, I really sent Kevin direction in advance. You know, I sent him in a long text, you know.
Right.
Here's kind of what we're looking for. So I really didn't have, you know, my direction had really been done other than, you know, point the camera, shoot everyone, introducing everyone to him.
Right, and it's like podcasting.
Mm-hmm. And,
like,
yeah.
Go.
Yeah,
like, go.
Well, yeah.
Just go.
Pretty much. That's
and
like,
he
podcasting
just talks.
Go.
The guy, there is nothing better.
Yeah.
And Big Daddy knows because he has a show, too. There's nothing better than having a guest that, like, talks. That just talks and goes and just, like, knows
just
what
goes
they...
And
just
goes and goes.
And the content is so great. Like, you just feel like, oh my God, this is the best moment ever.
Yeah.
This is so wonderful, what's happening right here.
Yes. Yes, indeed.
Yeah, and we just kind of let it happen. The kids were there, which was a big thrill.
Yeah, and they were a lot of fun, too.
And I got the vibe that Kevin was sort of placating or making, like,
Kevin doesn't, I guess, mind waiting, you know, going to the very last minute. And he was trying to give us all he could. And I think part of that was even, like, sending off his assistant, like, tilting at windmills practically, you know? Like,
and you know,
go do this busy work so I get 10 more minutes with these guys and you don't try and cut me off.
You know what the best is, though? His ass, because basically his ass was on fire because he had to get to the airport at a certain time.
Yeah.
But you never feel that way with him.
No.
You never feel like, okay, got to go now, bye. Like, you never feel like he's cutting you off to do something else that's more important.
Yeah,
right. He, like, plans it, like, to, like, the second. Like, okay, take my bags to the car because that's, so now I have more time with Scott. Like, I.
Yep.
And he plans it so he doesn't have to be the dick and has to just jump up and leave.
Yeah, yeah.
He's just a nice guy.
Very gracious.
He's really, really very sweet.
Gracious. Oh, yeah.
Gave us great stuff.
Excellent.
He is who he is. And then as he went out the door, he said, "You're doing a great job, Scott." And that was like, you know, hello, now I'm floating off the ground.
Yeah. Wait, really? Am I? I got to look down. Oh, yeah.
And, okay, now here's what I will say, and I don't know. And unlike last time he gave me a cool compliment, nobody died that night. So I didn't have to get all bummed out later.
Right.
So,
so you didn't have to feel bad about getting a compliment because someone died. Very cool. It was awesome.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, but that's not about Big Daddy.
Well, yeah, but okay, so we went that's and then after that was done, we were so sort of shagged out that we didn't even plan it. We did a podcast, I think, that night or that week, and then we just, like, collapsed.
And we took a nice, fun break. It was a good break.
We didn't do anything. I mean, I uploaded footage.
Yeah.
That's about it.
And there you go. That's about our number one moment of the show this year was shooting definitely with Kevin after our California trip. And the California trip, actually, I sort of encompassed all of that together as the coolest moment for us.
Oh,
you know, getting
my
to go
God,
out to Cali.
Guys.
And we shot with
the
a lot of people
ever
up
being
in Cali.
California.
Yeah, it was.
We loved it.
That was
LA.
That was it was a huge year for us, for the show, for the movie.
For the movie. And I know you guys are wondering what's going on, but more will be revealed.
Yeah. I mean, we're working on editing.
Yep, editing time.
Yeah, so you won't get the same kind of regular updates of everything.
Yeah.
And, you know, we'll mention when there's pickup shoots because there's still some pickups in the works.
Yeah, within
but
like the month or two.
It's just not intense and frantic like it was last year, or it shouldn't be. If it gets that way this year, then something's wrong.
Yeah. It's more of an internal kind.
And for those keeping track, we're shooting for Sundance 2018.
2018.
And I know people are like, oh, my God. But, hey, we want to do it right.
It's going to be right.
And that means that we have only about 9 months left to work on this thing.
And all y'all who sat for interviews, you know, we want it to be exactly perfect.
Yeah, we
want to
do
you
it.
Guys.
We don't want a piece of shit.
Yes.
You're going to want to be responsible for making garbage. do that again. All right. Well, we hope you've enjoyed this countdown. Mm-hmm. But I think it's at this time, it's a good point to go over to our long-lost friend, it feels like, Miss Tesdy Groupie, with the pick of the week. Now, she's at 97.
Wow.
This is the 97th pick. Now, if we'd gotten a few more shows in, she'd probably be at 100. But c'est la vie. So without any further ado, here's Miss Tesdy Groupie and her pick of the week. That Man on Fat Man presents. At Tesdy Groupies. Tell 'em Steve Dave. Pick of the week.
Hi, and welcome to the Tesdy Pick of the Week. This is a time of the year when we think of resolutions for the new year. And we'll look back and come up with all sorts of best-of lists. That is something that cannot be done with Tell 'em Steve Dave. Because how can the best episode of the year be picked up? Especially in such a good year as this one. So, no, I will not be doing that. But As an episode has to be selected, let's focus on an episode that marked a milestone for sure. Don't know which episode is that? How can that be? Well, let's clear all doubts and let's remember the event of the year. As this week's pick is TSD 300, Get 'em to the Chapel. If TSD is known for one thing, it's for World's Game, and also for event episodes. So what best way to celebrate 300 episodes than joining both? The premise of the episode is, two brides compete to marry Get 'em. And who will they compete? Well, they won't. Two teams will be drafted by Brian Q to determine the lucky gal by playing games. And there are classic TSD games and also new ones. And in between them, there are toasts from all the team contestants. In the spirit of not spoiling the episode, even if you surely have listened to it, I will leave it here so you can enjoy all 3 hours and 40 minutes of TSD magic, right to the very end, when I will say a wedding ceremony does take place. I wish everybody a great new year, and I hope you will listen to it. I hope you enjoy it, and you're all the way.
And there you have it.
Happy New Year, Argentina.
Happy New Year, everybody.
And everyone. And Tezzy 300 was a good pick.
Yes, I kind of expected that would be the pick. I mean, what
the
else
pick of
pick?
The year, yes.
Yeah, what else would you
That's
pick?
A long episode, so yeah, it's definitely a fun one.
Well, we hope that you have enjoyed this show. We hope you've enjoyed the past year of shows.
Yeah.
This year we weren't quite as prolific as we have been. We've only, even up until this point, what do we have, 37 shows or 36 shows?
Yeah.
So next one will be 37 in a row.
Be 37.
Maybe we'll make 40 by the end of the year, by the end of our year,
right?
Because we count to February.
Yeah.
It's weird because February rolls, but we've already done like a best of show for the year, so it's weird. But, so in the next few shows, look forward to that. Again, if you're... want to see some other stuff we do? I've been doing a show called Bone Crushing Juggernaut, mm-hmm. Monday through Friday. Just started that back up. We also do another show together called Tales from the Swing. Mm-hmm. Has a few episodes. It's still new. Look for more of that as the year goes on. And let's see.
That's been a lot of fun doing that.
Yeah, we're really enjoying that. It just lets us... Oh, you know what I just realized? People are just... They're not seeing us.
You're not seeing us.
They're seeing us now. Sorry,
guys.
How long
have you not been seeing us?
Yeah, just since the Tezzy groupie pick came back.
Okay.
So, yeah. It's been a fun year. It's been a lousy year for celebrity deaths. It's been a lousy year for presidential politics. But it's been a good year for ThatMan on Fatman.
Yeah.
It's been a good year for the movie we're working on. It's been a good year for, you know, the stuff we've been doing here on the show.
So for 2017, we're looking to continue that.
Yes, let's hope that 2017, at least from the show's perspective, is as good. And we hope that far less people we like die this year.
And try your thing. Do your thing.
Yeah. If we can encourage you, start your podcast. Do your web show.
Do your movie.
Whatever. Write your book. Write your novel. Write your script, your screenplay. Yeah. Take a chance. Say fuck it and do it anyway.
What's the worst thing that could happen?
Nothing. You waste your time. You lose some hours.
But
I guarantee you, if you write a script or do whatever,
or be honest,
it will never be seen as a waste.
Right. Because
you'll learn
up.
Something from it.
Or open up about something. Maybe just like take
get
a chance.
Get honest.
Take a chance. Be as honest as you feel comfortable.
Come out of the closet.
It's okay.
It's all right. It's safe out here.
It is.
We can speak
from
experience.
The water's fine.
You'll be all right. We promise.
We have a lot of people to help you along.
Go over to listen to Tales from the Swing.
Yeah.
Those last few episodes have been really good.
Yeah.
There's only been a few, but.
There's a lot of people that support you in everything. So just try it out.
And above all, you're smart and good. So let's look forward to a good 2017.
Yes. Love you guys.
We will see you and we will talk to you. Later. You're smart and good.
Bye, guys.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
I should probably find some music before I do this.
Get swifty.
No.
Swifty in here.
Why? No, we don't close with that.
I know.
We close with, I lost my freaking soundboard. Everything stinks when it's me. Where are you?
I'm right here.
I lost all my stuff. Wow. Oh. Sorry, guys. It's the video. It's totally fucking me up. Bye, folks. It's smart and good.
Bye.
One by one and smirking like a thief, sleeping through another night and deepening our peace. Genesis and Matt's wake is coming from our sun, living in this very moment, for this moment's done. All we'll ever be, while our souls do bind as one. Come join us if you please, if you please. At our shrine, bursting flowers into bloom. There's no such thing as time. Powers from our mother earth will blow us to our knees. Twisting, turning minds are burning. Join us if you please.
There he is. It's that man standing yeah. over Blood Alley Square, protecting us all. Go get him, that man. And now Nathra, unbox the food, Duffy and D&D.